Consider this an invitation to my gangster nation.
This game right here is rough as fuck. These hoes out here about the bucks. These fools out here afraid to bust. I have no fear, afraid of what. And with my peers, I'm coming up. Fools talk real loud, but don't run up. When we come through, they run and duck. We still right here, so what the fuck?
Welcome back to the Why So Serious podcast. I'm your host, Brandon.
I was not ready for that shit.
You weren't ready for that, see?
No, for her to say, Westside. Oh, shit.
You gotta rip hard for your coast.
You do.
So we have Los Angeles' own Sharmane back on the show. How's it going, Sharmane?
I'm all right. How y'all doing? I feel like I ain't talked to all y'all in forever.
Yes, it's been too long. That's why I had to get you back on. We missed you.
I missed you guys.
Are you going to talk about...
Devin and Mike are here, too.
I'm here. So, Sharmane, tell us about Bisexual Awareness Month.
Oh, starting it hard. Okay, so technically, September 23rd is Bisexual Visibility Celebration Day.
Thank you for that.
The week is, I think, September 22nd or 23rd through the 27th.
So, we still in the week?
We're still in the week. It's hashtag Bi Week. B-I Week. I guess, since people think bisexuals are greedy anyway, I might as well rock the brand. I took the whole month of September to celebrate bisexuals or anybody on the B+. And by B+, I mean anybody who has room in their attraction for more than one gender, the pansexuals, the omnisexuals, the heteroflexibles, the homoflexibles. So we're out here talking about, you're not going to erase us. We're out here. You got to make room for us too. There's 53% of the LGB part of the community is bisexual. So fucking recognize. And that's what we got going on right now.
Cool.
Well, that's why I just said that on Twitter.
Do you know that my dumb ass, I have been talking about bisexual visibility all fucking month. And then the 23rd. Not a fucking tweet.
Yeah, you missed it.
Not a post. I missed it. I was so busy. I fucking missed it. I was like, wow. Wow. Way to let down your team.
See, you failing. Mike, how are things with you?
Things are just fantastic. I haven't done any white people things since the last time.
How was camping?
I thought you went camping.
I missed this.
Yeah, but I already talked about it.
No, you were going camping. How was camping?
You know, I should never go camping and wake. I cannot do camping and scuba diving the same weekend. I was like, I think my body was actually shutting down. It's just too much. It's too much.
Have
but
y'all seen
my
Alone yet?
What?
Have you guys seen Alone from the History Channel?
No.
It's like one white person. Well, I think there was like one black dude, but it's like eight people go solo out into the wilderness in Patagonia. And they got to live for as long as they can live solo. They get to bring 10 items with them. And then they got to build a life out in Patagonia solo. And basically everybody taps out until the last man is standing. And that person gets $500,000.
Oh, I could do that for sure.
That's basically, I'll put it like this. I only watched a little bit. I had a friend in town and she was here and she exposed us to the show. The black dude tapped out in like 8 days. The winner, which was a grizzly ginger looking dude, he lasted 87 days.
Oh, that's too long, actually. Never mind.
$500,000.
I got too much to do.
87 days? Mm-mm. No, I can't take 87 days off of life.
Most of the women lasted pretty late. Like they basically one woman finally just like found her peace and she was just like 64 days or 72 days I'm out. I don't need the money anymore. I'm happy. And then one lady, she was like, they're gonna get me on my weight loss soon, so somebody better tap out because I'm at this point I'm just wasting away until I get that money. And then they pulled her because of her weight loss. And then the next day, the guy, you know, basically they give him one more day and then they win. So that's, it was women up until the end. One guy lasted her one day. It was crazy.
Is that still on TV?
Yeah, it's on like History Channel on Hulu or whatever. So there's like three seasons. We only watched the last season, I think. And it was only because I had a friend in town exposing us to it. I was like, you know what? I could deal with the solitude because I don't like people. But I'm not about that. I can't be out there in the world trying to take care of.
So you could do naked.
So Sharmane. Oh, no. Fuck no.
No, I don't have survival skills. Like, I don't have like, I can't like get
food survive. For
myself, shit like that. No, like,
you could, my... Mike, you're the least survival of us.
What? Are you serious? I can breathe underwater. So what?
No, you need an apparatus to breathe underwater.
Yeah, but maybe. I have received various trainings.
So everywhere surviving is not near water. What if I put you out in the desert?
Yeah.
I have a Kevlar bat suit. I'm pretty sure
Kevlar is not going to help you in the hot sun and sand. Listen,
half of my body would be fine. The other half of me would degrade. It's fine. I'd be fine. Yeah.
Like, so I Sharmane, can't, like, kill anything willing... to survive, but, like, I could be where, like, nobody is around. I could do solitary, because I grew up in a Japanese house with a grandma who didn't speak to me for 3 months because she was mad at me about something I didn't know what she was mad about.
I just watched a documentary about people who spent, like, 40 years in solitary confinement, and they're not right. I don't know if that you should do
well,
that.
Well, that's no. true, but, like,
yeah, Michael.
They probably
say
weren't
40 years.
I said, like, 87 days. In
I'm
silence,
just messing around.
I could do 87 days in silence.
So, Sharmane, are you willing to agree that men are the better gender?
No, because the men always tap out. The like, if you watch Naked and Afraid,
I know,
and
yeah.
Alone, like it's like mostly the men tap out, and then like a bunch of hardy bitches get through to the end.
So, no, I will say that on Naked and Afraid, the women that have some experience usually go longer, but they get a lot of women that don't even know what they're doing, and like they tap out really quick. Yeah,
I don't
like,
think you watch that show,
Naked and Afraid.
Yeah,
like the pros. Yeah, I do watch it, but the pros, like, because they have people come back a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but yeah, but those women are pretty good, and they carry their male partners for the most part. But now Naked and Afraid, they're doing all pros, so like they're people actually getting through the whole. Making it to their mark and getting out of the jungle or whatever extreme situation they've been placed in. So it's been cool.
The alone thing was cool because they got to a point where basically the people were creating like culture for themselves. This one lady built like a sweat lodge. She built a guitar. She built like another lady built a drum. Like they got to the point where they were so efficient in their survival that they had time to be like, you know what is missing in my life? A guitar. And yeah, it was.
That's
it's
dope.
Way.
I'm not doing
it's
that.
Way like I was all about Naked Afraid until I saw this. I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna watch some weird white people do some solitaire survival shit. Why not?
I don't know how people go Naked and Afraid and act like sleeping on the ground, butt ass naked, is something you can come to terms with when shit is crawling on you.
Yeah.
And
no.
Yeah, I just touching a branch naked. I'm ready to go home. Can't do it.
Yeah. No. I mean, I do my massages with panties on because I don't want anything crawling up in my goodness when I'm on the table. Like, no, it's not going to happen. I need panties at least.
Yeah, I third that one. Devin, how was your anime week?
Anime, I've been, oh my God, I've just been down a rabbit hole. Like, there's so many good shows I've been watching. Demon Slayer just watch Demon Slayer. It's really good. I started a new anime. It's called No Acceleration.
What was the black anime called again?
Cannon Busters.
Cannon Buster. Yeah.
Really good. I've been watching Black Clover. All caught up from Black Clover now. And I started Dr. Stone. Dr. Stone is just like fucking Alone, Naked and Afraid or some shit like that, right? So what happens is something happened in Japan. And everybody turned to stone, right? So.
I wonder what could have inspired that. Fucking bomb, maybe?
You know, that's facts. So 3,700 years go by, and then the main character wakes up out of his stone casing and his husk or whatever. So he was a super smart kid, a genius. Like, I guess, like, he made a rocket when he was a little kid, and he has some friends to help him in his science experiments and shit like that. So he gets out of the stone casing first, and then he works to get everybody else out. And there's like 13 episodes in, and they're restarting civilization, and it's great. It's primal. It's intuitive. You get to learn about some different compounds that you didn't know, how to start life. And it's fascinating so far. And I'm like, I'm only 10 episodes and I haven't caught up to where we're at, where the current episode is, but it's really cool. Dr. Stone. And then what else? Boruto is great. I watched a couple.
Pronunciation just drives me crazy.
Yeah. No, you know, look, I was over there in Japan. I was like, somebody just tell me how to say it, because it's not going to come out right any other time. So, I was in Shibuya and was like, that's not how you say it. that's not how you say it.
Nah. Sorry.
I was just pointing at things.
Kaweso.
Yeah, all those. None of those. I could pronounce none of the stops on the train. So it was fun, though. But yeah, I've been working ever since I got back from Japan. So this is my only day off, and I'm glad I'm here with you guys.
All right, wonderful. So we'll sprinkle some other
things
in
between. What about you? We never hear about you. You always make everybody explain what they got going on. What you got going on, Brandon?
I'm not doing nothing. I'm playing Madden. I've been reading. I'm starting to reread Watchmen for Mike.
Okay.
Do you mean read it for the first time?
Yeah, read it for the first time. I've watched the movie, but I'm reading the
comic. Wow.
Sorry. I'm reading Watchmen, and I caught up on Immortal Hulk. Mike, did you read the X-Men books yet?
Yes.
No, you didn't. You're lying.
I was about to say, you can't know.
No, I just got back.
Oh my gosh. So Mike is avoiding like the best comic book out right
now.
No,
I'm going to read it.
Just avoiding it.
Are you talking about House and Powers?
Yes.
I have all of them literally right behind me.
I have them too. I'm 2 weeks behind. They're sitting on my desk, but I'm 2 weeks behind. I had someone here. I had two people in town this last 2 weeks. So I'm going to be caught up by tonight probably, or tomorrow.
Overachiever. Can't do it.
And I'm moving in a month. And the first show that we're going to have in Texas, Devin, Lauren and Gabby are going to be on.
I mean, it's only right. Yeah, it's only right.
Local?
They're in Houston. I'll be in Dallas.
Oh, okay.
But relatively local. Relatively. All right. So I'll sprinkle in some other things as we go. But I want to start off with this funny story that I heard on last podcast on the left. And none of you are probably expecting this. But we'll start with that.
It's the last podcast on the left. I'm expecting it, sir.
Mom claimed Ukrainian daughter she adopted
I saw this.
Was really a 22-year-old dwarf. Did you see that?
No, I didn't.
Yeah, I saw that. I didn't read the whole thing, but I saw the
and a
pictures.
Spy.
I mean, you have to be a spy,
yeah,
though.
Russian, yeah. Right? So
it has all the elements of a horror movie. An unsuspecting Christian couple adopts an adorable little girl, only to discover she is an adult sociopath masquerading as a child. If the premise sounds familiar, that's because it's virtually the exact same plot from 2009 big screen chiller Orphan, where a pigtail youngster tries to murder her family when it's revealed she is 33. But as far-fetched as it sounds, this is the astounding defense put forward by a mom of three and parenting author, shockingly accused of felony neglect for abandoning her adopted daughter. Kristen Barrett, 45, and her ex-husband, Michael Barrett, 43, are alleged to have dumped Ukrainian-born Natalia Grace at an apartment in Lafayette, Indiana, in 2013 before moving to Canada 1 month later. Police say the girl was left to fend for herself for 3 years despite having a rare form of dwarfism that means she is 3 foot tall and has problems walking. But an exclusive interview.
But like, if she is actually a grown ass woman, she was fine, right?
Well, an exclusive interview with Daily Mail at an undisclosed location, Christine insists there's a major flaw in their case. Natalia was not a 9-year-old, as charging documents claim. She was actually 22. Barnett claims the true victims are her and her family, who were terrorized for years by the mysterious imposter who threatened to stab them in their sleep. pushed her towards an electric fence and poured bleach in her coffee. That happened.
Sounds like someone I'm related to by marriage.
The movie orphaned exactly what happened. She would make statements and draw pictures saying she wanted to kill family members, roll them up in a blanket, and put them in the backyard. She was standing over people in the middle of the night. You couldn't go to sleep. We had to hide all sharp objects.
Hey, remember my old crazy roommate? It was like him.
This was much worse than him. Natalia was a... The media is painting me to be a child abuser, but there's no child here. Natalia was a woman. She had periods. She had adult teeth.
She had periods.
She never grew a single inch, which would happen even with a child with dwarfism. So they got her when she was 6 years old. And they said she was having periods and had pubic hair. The doctors all confirmed she was suffering from a severe psychological illness, only diagnosed in adults. She was jumping out of moving cars. She was smearing blood on mirrors. She was doing things you could never imagine a little child doing. I don't know. What do you think,
Devin?
So
she definitely had, like, mental illness in addition to the dwarfism.
I'm just so perplexed because where was her speech at? I don't have enough, you know, enough evidence or enough details to go like she's a full on dwarf. But like, yeah, you say she has a period, like we going to the doctor ASAP. As soon as I see one drop, what? My 6 year old, my 7 year old is having a period? No, this isn't right. But yeah, people let shenanigans go like that for a long time. So it doesn't surprise me. She could be a whole dwarf.
What do you think, Mike?
I think I'm scared and I would be calling I don't know who I would be calling, but I'd be calling somebody. Probably you.
You should
Brandon,
be running.
What do I do?
They got up and moved to Canada. That's what you do.
I wouldn't go to Canada. I'd go somewhere. I'd go south. I think I'd go south.
But here's the thing. The husband thinks that she was a child and that the mom is trash.
Mm. Wouldn't he know if she was a child?
He doesn't believe her.
Is there any pictures? Can we see?
There are pictures.
Let me. Can you? I want to look.
Let me see.
Because I read this article, but I didn't. I saw it. It came up on one of my social media things, but I didn't see what anyone in this story looked like.
But like, if the dad thinks she's lying, why did the dad go with the mom?
Well, he still had a kid that's trying to kill him.
It concludes she was aged properly. Okay. At further skeletal tests carried out 2 years later at the same facility concluded she was around 11 years old. The affidavit reveals that it was Natalia herself who told police in 2014 that she had been left alone with her adoptive parents, moved to Canada with cops, concluding she was a reliable and credible witness. It does not explain, however, why detectives waited 5 years to put the allegations to Michael Barnett, who divorced Christine in 2014, remarried, and has settled back in Indiana. The document says that when an officer spoke with Michael on September 5th, he admitted he knew all along that Natalia was a minor child when she was allegedly abandoned. Furthermore, the affidavit adds, Michael Barnett admitted Christine Barnett told Natalia to tell others Natalia looks young but was actually 22. However, his Indianapolis-based attorney, Terrence Kennard, denied that his clients made any such admissions of guilt. The police affidavit is not true. Police knocked on Michael's door, and he spoke to them for 3 hours without an attorney present. As for Natalia, neither the Barnetts, their attorneys, nor seemingly anyone else involved in the baffling case appears to know her whereabouts. And despite the possibility she is now 30 years old, Natalia's full court records will remain sealed until a court decides otherwise because adoption cases are treated as confidential.
So they can't find her.
She's missing.
Okay.
So what are they being charged with? Abandonment of a child that may not be a child?
Wait, who's missing? The dwarf
who may be a child or a grown ass woman.
Okay, that's terrifying. Missing.
They don't know where she's at. With Christine and Michael Barrett both vociferously proclaiming their innocence, is a question that would likely not go away. I've been cooperative the whole time. I've been truthful. I am being charged by the state of Indiana for crimes against a child when the state of Indiana has determined multiple times that Natalia was an adult. Added Christine, who asked for her location to remain confidential over threats her family have received. From day one, this was an admission of love, but when you bring a child into your home, you expect them to be a child. To be accused of this is unconscionable to me. It's just horrifying. Kristen Barnett surrendered to authorities on Thursday, September 19th, and released after posting a $5,000 bond. Ex-husband Michael surrendered in Lafayette on September 18th. He was immediately released after his mugshot taken and posting a $5,000 bail. So what do you think? She's a child or not?
I don't know.
Like, just off the article, that's not enough to determine. I definitely want to see, like, actual evidence of some sort.
Whites being whites, because if you believe in this little girl telling you she grown, if this little girl ain't grown.
She had a skeletal test, and the skeletal test said that she was older. And she said that at 6 years old, when she washed her in the bathtub, that she had pubic hair.
Oh, fuck no. Yeah. No.
That's what the mom said.
Yeah.
But then.
But again, like, that's hearsay unless you see that skeletal thing. If that skeletal report is available, I'd like to see it, and then that would determine my thing. Either way, like, if she's a full grown woman who's clearly suffering from some sort of mental illness, that because she's threatening to stab her adoptive parents and shit like that, then abandoning her, I think, is still wrong. You gotta get her the help that you need. You took on this journey to adopt this person. You expected a child. It turned out to be an adult. But, yeah, like, you can't just... I mean, if you're really afraid, don't you have to go to the authorities? Don't you have to get her help?
If you're really afraid, you gotta leave. Like on It, Part 2, where he ran into the boy. And he said... he's like, don't go here. The clown's talking. He's like, no, the clown's talking in my bathroom. And the dude was like, you need to leave now. Get your family and leave now. But he ain't leaving and he died. See, that's what happens.
All right, moving on. What's it?
New show. There's a new show on TV called Murder House Flip. Did you see that? No. Yes. No.
Hold on. No. No.
So it's like Fixer Upper, but for houses where like murder houses and haunted houses.
That's dope. I'm down.
A new, a totally unconventional series called Murder House Flip is coming soon. Exactly what it sounds like: home makeover show that takes on houses where a murder happened. Kind of creepy.
I live in that house.
You would live in that house.
I live in a murder house. I mean, I came in, my headphones died. I came in partway through, but like, I ain't scared of no murder house. There's no such thing as things.
So you were
like, okay, some shit went down.
You would live
in
OJ's house in Brentwood?
It's not there anymore.
What happened to it? They tore it down?
They knocked it down. Exactly. Some person bought that line.
Exactly. Nobody wants to live in OJ's murder house.
Well, okay, so the house that Nicole was murdered at, they didn't knock that down. They just built a new wall so that you can't actually see the front entrance. You got to go around now. Okay, full disclosure, I have a fascination with murder, and I drive around to murder houses.
Yes!
So, like, you can't see the house, you can't see the gateway where Nicole and Ron were killed. OJ's house was flattened by someone who bought the property, flattened it. They dug some shit up. They found the knife. A knife ended up being framed in some cop's house, which still had blood on it. Instead of taking it back to the authorities all these years later, he decided to frame that shit and put it in his house like an idiot. But, like, what are you afraid of? That years ago somebody died in it? Who cares?
There's some bad juju there.
There's no juju. There's no ghost. Just calm the fuck down. Someone died.
So you don't believe in ghosts?
Man, I've got a.
Did
I've
you say that like I'm the weird one?
No, but I'm just saying. I'm shocked that you don't believe in ghosts.
Why would you think I believe in ghosts? What have ever indicated? I don't believe in anything mystical.
Oh, I mean, your Japanese heritage would definitely, you know. But okay, never mind.
I took a harassment.
Not all Japanese believe in ghosts.
That's inappropriate, Devin. You just assumed something.
Yeah, tell her, no. Mike. Tell him, Mike.
You know, that is correct.
So, Mike got my back. There's no ghosts. There's no deities. No astrology. All that stuff is bullshit to me. Okay. I'm not afraid of no murder house. I'm going to move in a murder house.
So, you don't believe
I'll put
in
it like
aliens
this.
Either? No aliens?
I mean, aliens aren't mystical, right? Like, all we're talking about with aliens is
powers.
All we're talking about with aliens is that there's life on other planets.
They could be superpowered.
That is 100% within the realm of possibility because we're a life on a planet. The question is whether or not they have the technology and the skills to come here. That's a different story.
You don't think there's aliens like Thanos out there?
I mean, I'd like to see if there is, but I don't, like I don't not have any see. Evidence.
I would prefer,
I'm an evidence-based believer.
I would prefer not to see Thanos.
I mean, yeah, obviously Thanos is not the best guy you want to come out here, but if there's like a, I don't know, a sexy Twi'lek or some fucking, you know, some
you
shit like
are
that.
Hoping for Thor is what you're hoping for.
Thor, I mean, Thor's fun and all, but like people think he's a god. That's silly. He's just a being from another planet.
He's got
talents, obviously. He's got magic, but he's not a god or nothing.
Mike, would you live in a murder house?
No.
Okay, so you know what I did do? This is going to freak y'all out if you think that me living in a murder house is bad. I shot a movie about 6-7 years ago at the Lizzie Borden house. Lizzie Borden house. And we shot one of the scenes in the room that the stepmother was murdered at. And my crew, like some of my people were like nervous because they're Massachusettsians and for some reason they all believe in ghosts and shit. And so I was like, there's nothing to be afraid of. So I laid down where the stepmom died and it flipped everybody out.
Yeah,
like,
I would have.
What's going to happen to you? Da 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 da.
Nah, right. I just would have freaked me out that you would have did that shit. But I mean, like,
well,
I mean,
that 100 years ago, someone was murdered where I laid down. What about walking into a Burger King where someone got where there's a drive-by? It's the same shit. It's like there's no Burger King ghosts. Nope. Everybody needs to calm down.
Nope. That's not the same thing.
I have a haunted statue in my bedroom. He makes the TV turn green sometimes.
Fuck out of here, Mike. What are you talking about?
I bought a Batman statue.
There's something wrong with the television,
ever
sir.
Ever since I put it in here, weird shit happens. I hear weird noises. Keep getting weird insects. But I think we're cool.
Charmaine,
why don't you take the statue out if you actually believe that the statue is doing shit?
We're cool right now. I don't want to piss it off.
Wow.
See, Charmaine never seen a horror movie. She would be the first.
I've seen all kind of horror movies, and yeah, what's to be afraid of?
She's the first one to die.
So my mom. She's
no, because I'm far too practical to be caught up in these situations.
And the naysayer always dies first. Like, oh, we got nothing to be scared of.
I didn't say you don't have nothing to be scared of. If there's a mass murderer going door to door killing people, you got some shit to be scared of. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's a mystical being you got something to be scared of, but there's shit you don't do. You don't run out in a button up with no panties and no shoes and run upstairs. You're going to get killed. Boom.
See?
There is something to be worried about. You just
If you were in bed and that's what you had on? Then you got to run. With that on.
Who doesn't put shoes next to their bed in case they got to run?
Listen, if I got
someone who
the house,
wasn't,
I sleep with an ancient dagger from Central America.
There are shoes next to your bed. If you're smart, if you grew up in the hood, if things go down and you got to run, you got to have your shoes next to the bed so you can put your feet in them and run out the window or whatever the fuck you got to do.
I got two knives and a flamethrower under my bed, ready to go.
Your flamethrower
doesn't seem like the most practical thing to have.
Flamethrower. It's the best thing to have.
No, the worst thing.
You burn down everything. Everything got to go.
I will not be surprised if I hear a story. I'll be sad, but I would not be surprised if I hear a story that Mike tragically died in a flamethrower accident. Between the four of us right now, you are the most likely to die of flamethrower.
100% true. You're 100% true.
You better not, Mike. You better not.
Don't do it.
Some kick left at me.
All right. Next. Netflix has acquired the global streaming rights to Seinfeld, all 180 episodes. If you don't like Seinfeld, something wrong with you.
I love Seinfeld. Right, I hate Jerry.
You don't like Jerry?
What? You don't like Jerome? First of
Jerry's
all, Jerome.
A dick. Have you
his
seen
name is Jerome.
Jerry, like, being regular, his real-life Jerry? Jerry himself is a dick.
No, he's not.
He's kind of arrogant.
Oh, my gosh.
He's a bit arrogant, but he has the right to be arrogant.
He's got full on like rich white superiority. All you gotta do is watch that Coffee for Comedians thing, and you're like, wow.
But he was the most reasonable one on there.
He is.
He was the one where he was on there with Chris Rock and the other dude.
Eddie Murphy was really good.
It was Chris Rock and was it Louis C.K. and him? And they were talking.
Oh, that was a long time ago.
They were talking about saying "nigger," and Jerry Seinfeld was like, "Yeah, nah. You shouldn't do that, bro. Like, that's not good."
Okay, so he's at least smart about this one thing, but he also had an episode with Bill Maher in which he was pissed off about the line to the bathroom. Like, why do I gotta wait in the line to the bathroom? I'm fucking Jerry Seinfeld.
That's his humor, though. That's his humor.
Okay, that's why.
Sounds like something Jerry Seinfeld would say in a set, though.
Right.
What's the deal with the line in the bathroom?
He means that shit, though.
I mean, we all kind of mean that shit. You know what I mean? Like, it'd be little shit like that irks you, but we find it, his observational humor, funny. Because
I find Jerry to be a bit of an asshole, yes. But more of like an arrogant asshole, not like a terrible person asshole. Although I'm sure he's a rich white man, so he probably has some terribleness.
But I mean, on the Larry scale, David.
No, Larry David is awesome.
I prefer Larry David to
Larry David's the GOAT. I love Larry David. I would love to hang out with
him. I mean, I'm a curmudgeon.
He's an asshole.
Game recognized.
Larry's an asshole. A whole asshole.
He's a curmudgeon. It's a difference.
Yes, he's both.
He's just cantankerous. That's all.
Mike
he's
doesn't
adorable.
Even know who Larry David is, do you, Mike?
First of all, I know who Larry David is.
No, you don't.
From Curb Your Enthusiasm?
He would only know him from Curb. He wouldn't know him.
Well,
yeah, because
I made Mike watch Curb Your Enthusiasm. It's the best. Can't wait till it comes back. So basically, Netflix paid, they think, at least $500 million over 5 years. Warner Media just paid $425 million for Friends. That's going to be Warner Max shit.
Oh, so Friends is going to pop off of Netflix and end up on whatever Warner
shit? Yeah, they told you that, though.
It's going to be on HBO Max, I think.
Okay.
Oh, no. The Office, the former will be leaving service in a year for... No, The Office is going to HBO Max. So Netflix is losing The Office, and they're losing Friends, but they're gaining Seinfeld. I don't know. That's a win-win to me.
It's a big win, yeah.
Fuck Friends. But I will be watching Seinfeld.
I mean, I watch Seinfeld on Hulu, because
when Seinfeld pops up, you just watch it, like you just do.
All right, so let's get into some of these Joker stories since that comes out next week.
Fuck that shit.
Oh shit!
The Joker movie will not be screening in Aurora Theater where the shooting occurred for The Dark Knight.
They make that link though. They made the link.
I mean, they shouldn't. I wouldn't want it there either. And I'm pretty sure the victims don't want that shit there either.
It was after Batman anyway when it happened. I mean, it was during Batman when it happened.
Yeah,
so
The Dark Knight.
The link is there.
Yeah, and this movie's supposed to be like super incel-y, which I
kind of don't want to see it anymore.
I don't want to see it.
I'm not excited for it, but I will see it. But
I will see it.
I just know I'm expecting, especially with Todd Phillips continuing to talk, it's just, I don't know. Like, what does he think he's going to get out of telling people all this shit? First of all, they talked about how this movie's going to be so edgy and it's going to be this and that. And now people are coming at them talking about this movie promotes violence and, like, specifically the type of violence that's happening already, like the white male angry person violence. And now they're coming out saying, no, it's not that, blah, blah, blah. Like, dog, you knew what you were doing. So, like, they just had somebody was just interviewing them, The Rap. And so they were talking to Todd Phillips, the director. And he was like, we didn't make the movie to push buttons, Phillips told The Rap in the interview Friday about the filmmaker process. I literally described to Joaquin Phoenix. No, Joaquin. What am I talking about, Joaquin? Joaquin Phoenix.
I was like, what the fuck?
At one point in
those
3 months as like, look at this as a way to sneak a real movie in the studio system under the guise of a comic book film. What the hell does that mean?
Yeah.
A real movie?
That's so arrogant.
Like, what does that even mean? It wasn't. We want to glorify this behavior. It was literally like, let's make a real movie with a real budget, and we'll call it fucking Joker. That's what it was. Who is this press for?
And even, are you going to tell me that nothing in the MCU counts as a real movie? Like, there's actual legit emotion and drama and test of will. Like, there's, it's not just an action movie. There's some shit going on in these movies.
I guarantee there's going to be a large amount of movies better than this one. Like, not even, like, did I like better? Because I'm pretty sure I'm going to like most of the MCU movies better. But, like, just objectively better films, I'm pretty sure this will not be better than every MCU movie when it comes out.
He was whining earlier today or yesterday about, like, why didn't they pan against John Wick 3 for the same kind of violence? And somebody said Keanu or whatever, but, like, it's a totally different thing. This guy set out to make a movie not only to, like, kind of piss off comic book fans by saying I'm going to call something Joker and make no Joker bits in there, but then to also be like, I'm making a real movie, and I'm still, like, you're just insulting all, you're just alienating a whole bunch of people that might have been down for your movie if you just, like,
didn't say
weren't
anything.
A dick. Yeah. Like, just weren't a dick.
Like it says, Warner Brothers, the filmmaker behind Joker, and now movie theater chain Regal Cinemas are all going on the defensive against criticisms that the upcoming DC Comics adaptation glamorizes and trivializes the same kind of persona that has destabilized so much of the United States through mass shootings and other flamboyant criminal acts. Such criticisms hit hard and early when a version of the screenplay was leaked online, and critics noted that the fundamental idea of the movie seemed to center around making a middle-aged white male on a trajectory to commit mass murders into a sympathetic protagonist. That is what I've been afraid of this entire time. I've said it over and over on the show. Yeah. You cannot make the Joker sympathetic. Like, there's nothing, like, he's not a sympathetic figure. That is a horrible idea. That concern
is chaotic evil.
Yeah, he's pure evil. There's nothing sympathetic about him. That concern has only picked up steam as the movie has begun to get screened for audiences, racking up critical accolades and seemingly on a pace to make huge money in its opening weekend. After law enforcement became concerned about the potential for violence at Joker screenings, not least of all because of the supposedly Joker-inspired mass shooter openly shot in Colorado, The Dark Knight Rises. Other movie theater chains, including Landmark and AMC, issued brief statements acknowledging the concerns and promising to beef up security and limit what costumes audience members could wear for the movie. At Regal, we do not believe the content of the existence of any movie is a cause or signal for violence. Nevertheless, although we do not comment on security protocols implemented by our theaters at any time, patron and employee safety is our foremost concern. In collaboration with NATO, we are in regular contact year-round with law enforcement, so we have information to help make whatever security assessments deem appropriate. So basically, AMC and Landmark was like, listen, we understand that shit, people, some white crazy white men are going to take this shit too seriously, so we're going to beef up security. Regal was like, yeah fuck that. We don't give a shit. Show up. For his part, star Joaquin Phoenix walked out of an interview when asked about the concerns. Filmmaker Ty Phillips first tried to address the concerns, but seems to have tired talking about it and is now just blaming, quote, outrage culture. Yo, what is this film?
Yo,
bro?
True. Yeah.
Is this just fucking, this has to, you know, it's all tone. I think one of the biggest jobs of the director is you're the purveyor of tone, and this movie was always written and meant to be a slow burn, and I think the violence is part of that slow burn. We were very careful, I think, with it. A lot of people assume or think it's going to be a really violent movie, but if you break it down to the amount of people that Arthur has a problem with, I think the reason it affects you differently, I mean, you can watch a movie like John Wick 3, and there's a much higher amount of violence. The violence is not the point. Like, people getting shot or killed is not the point. It's the way
it's
you portray
the psychology.
It's the intent,
that person.
It's the psychology, yeah.
Yeah.
John Wick getting chased by a bunch of hitmen and him killing the hitman to survive is not the same as white dude who is probably a piece of shit who women don't like and people don't think is funny gets mad and decides to take that out into society, and I'm supposed to be feeling sorry for him because women didn't want to fuck him. That's not the
same. And why not, like, if you're not going to make him the Joker, and you're just going to make this kind of crazy, insane eagle guy who wears a clown face, just call it a clown. Like, don't lace it into the Joker mystique, because that's going to give all the wrong things. I mean, I hate already that, like, I wasn't down for it the second they announced it with Joaquin and everything like that. I'm very adamantly opposed to Joaquin still having a career after all the shit he's done anyway. And then on top of it, like, I'm kind of mad because sometimes the trailer looks good. Not all the trailers, but some of the trailers looks good. And I'm like, fuck, this is probably going to be a little bit decent, but I'm not going to be able to get it out of my head that they're claiming it's a Joker movie. But then he kisses Zazie, and I'm full back on to trigger and enraged. There's something so wrong about that whole thing. But this director needs to shut the fuck up. He sounds so incel and triggered about every single thing. Like, you don't like my movie. And it's not even out yet.
Sounds like this is nothing a movie about for this. Comicsgate and Gamergate people.
Like, why do it's like you made the movie gate for at the end of shit.
Sticking
why
with
do we
DC,
still do that?
Yeah, oh, Mike, what do you think? What do you think about this? Are you you said you're not as excited for the film?
I'm not as excited to see it anymore because I get it, and I agree. It's not even about the Joker, like.
Yeah, it's,
just a movie about a crazy clown who's sucked at life.
If the, here's the funny thing.
It seems more like a Gacy movie, right? Because basically, in terms of serial killers.
Yeah,
like it seems more like that. Like
it's like Kings of Comedy. The King of Comedy.
You broke up for that. I didn't hear you.
I said it's like the King of Comedy. Essentially, Brandon. From the 70s.
Brandon?
Can y'all hear me?
Got to him.
All right, we're back. Had a little bit of a connection drop, but we are back. Mike, what were you saying about the movie?
I'm just not, like, the appeal to it is gone for me, really. It's not about the Joker. The only way I'm going to see it is for the show, you know, like for whatever we're going to do. And I'm not going opening weekend, definitely, for a number of reasons. And then I think I'm going to go to, like, a Tuesday matinee showing. I agree with everything you said. It's lost its like the first trailer looked kind of interesting and cool, and then everyone started talking about it, and then now it's become this thing. And I don't know. I'm just not as into it as I was before. It's not worth it.
What about you, Devin?
I'll go see it if you want to review it. I mean, I just never, you know, I never was on board with this shit ever, even though the trailers look interesting, but. Like you said, the psychology behind this is going to trigger a lot of people. So it could be a dangerous movie as far as like going forward, because it gives those people that energy that they can, you know, take justice or their feelings into their own hands and do harm to other people. So, yeah, I'm out. I'm not really here for it, not unless you want to review it.
Yeah, we'll review it. Rashani wants to review it, so. We'll see, but Joaquin and Todd Phillips have just. I already was skeptical because I didn't think a Joker movie should have been made to begin with, even if they were doing the actual Joker. But they just made it even worse. But speaking of Batman, the Batman universe, we're starting to get some more casting announcements from Matt Reeves' the Batman movie, and it looks like Jeffrey Wright from Westworld and Jonah Hill will be in this film. So what do you think about those castings and who do you think they would play? The rumors are that Jeffrey Wright will be playing
Penguin.
No, Jeffrey Wright will be playing James Gordon and Jonah Hill will be playing the Penguin. If those are true, and then there's also or that Hill will be up for the Riddler as well. So if those are true, could you see Jonah Hill as the Penguin or the Riddler? And could you see Jeffrey Wright as Commissioner Gordon?
That's the black dude, right?
Yeah, that's the bald black dude from
Westworld. Okay, I think I've seen this. I mean, I think he could be a good Commissioner Gordon, but I just don't know what the Batman's going to be. So, I mean, go for it. I mean, I'm always down to see a good story come out on screen. So, however it works out, I really
There's
don't
a rumor that they're going to do the Long Halloween. Which would be super dope if they could pull that off.
A little weird.
Why you say that?
Well, I don't know. How are they going to do the ending?
That's an excellent question. But it doesn't have to be an exact adaptation of the comic.
They'd have to change the identity of Holiday, I think, for it to work.
What do you think, Sharmane? Oh, go ahead, Mike.
They'd have to change the holiday.
Did you read The Long Halloween?
No, I did not.
The serial killer's name is Holiday.
Copy that.
You should read it. It's one of the best Batman stories. It's really good.
I will put it on my list.
It's really, really good.
But I'm saying they'd have to change the identity of Holiday for the ending to work. And then I'm more here for... This is the unpopular opinion. I mean, not... I mean, the popular opinion is that they're both good, but good choices. But I'm more here for the Gordon casting than the Penguin casting. I just can't see him
in... What's the Penguin casting? I missed that altogether.
So, Jonah Hill. Jeffrey Wright as Gordon, and then either Jonah Hill... as either the Riddler or Penguin.
Jonah Hill? He doesn't really have the chops for that kind of stuff.
Apparently he does.
I've seen Jonah Hill.
Jonah Hill's not bad.
He can act. I just don't know. People put him in the Penguin because he's fat, but I could absolutely see him more as the Riddler than the Penguin.
I mean, I'm not saying he can't act, but I'm saying like the acting chops to be Penguin or the Riddler.
I don't want like the goofy Penguin. I want like the Arkham Penguin, the one that's like really like sinister and aggressive and like actually threatening.
What about Jeffrey Wright? What do you think about that casting?
I have no problem with that.
I like that one actually. I know people are freaking out about like, is everyone going to be shifted black? If the character's race doesn't matter, like, if it's not integral to who they are, then shifting ethnic groups and stuff like that doesn't bother me. Jeffrey Wright is a really talented fucking actor. Mm-hmm. And as he's getting older, I mean, he's got that slow, silent thing going on, which I think is kind of, for me, that's Gordon, is that kind of measure.
His pauses are great, yeah.
You know, yeah, that kind of thing. So I think he works really well for that. For Penguin or Riddler, I mean, what kind of Riddler are we talking about? Are they doing proper Riddler? Are we going towards Hush? What are we doing with Riddler now?
Yeah, they're doing Jeff Loeb's era of Batman, so they're doing more of the dark, sinister characters.
Okay.
You can't do it.
I don't know. I just don't know that he's right. I mean, I'm not saying that he doesn't have his talents. I'm saying I don't know that either the Penguin or the Riddler is for him in terms like, because like, I wouldn't find him very threatening.
He'd be a great Batmite.
No, come on, Batmite.
That's it. That's what I'm telling you.
Wait, you want to be that's Mr. Mistleplick too?
Mr. Mistlepiddalick.
Mr. Piddalick.
Mr. Piddalick.
Mitzel Piddalick.
I can never say that shit. Who has ever said it properly?
Me.
All right. Superman. I'll take your word for it. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know who I would want for that. I don't know.
The casting has never been an issue with DC, so I imagine that they'll get a good cast. And if they let Matt Reeves tell his story, it'll be a good film. He's a very good director. So we'll see. Last DC news is the original Wonder Woman, Linda Carter, is rumored to be making a return for the Crisis on Infinite Earths crossover. Now, for those who watch Supergirl, Linda Carter played the President of the United States and an alien on the show for a couple seasons, and then she got booted out of office because they found out that she was a Martian, and so all the racist people didn't want her to be president. But the rumor is that she might come back as an older version of Wonder Woman in Crisis. Would you all be here for an older Linda Carter Wonder Woman appearance on the CW?
Every time. If she hits a spin, I'm here for it 1,000%.
I would actually, I haven't been watching the CW show. Like, I tried to watch Black Lightning, I tried to watch Flash, and that was the extent of it. But I actually would probably tune in to watch it if I knew Crisis of Infinite Earth was going to happen for sure, and I knew that Linda Carter was going to play old Wonder Woman.
So Crisis is happening. It's a 4-part episode at the end of the year.
Okay, then I will watch
and
that.
And they're bringing
it's like
Tom
a
Welling.
Part episode. What are you talking about?
No, it's 4. I think it's 4.
It's 6.
Is it 6?
Okay. Are they going to do it on all the different shows? Are they going to link them, or is it going to be okay?
So like Tom Welling, Superman from Smallville is coming back, and Kevin Conroy is going to be playing Bruce Wayne. Brandon Ross is going to be playing Superman again.
But he's on that other one, and he's terrible.
He's on Legends of Tomorrow as the Atom. He's okay. He's okay as the Atom.
His voice. I mean, I only watched one episode.
He always looks like he's about to cry.
His voice.
He always. He always looks like he's about to cry. Even when something great is happening to his character, he looks like he's about to cry.
John Wesley Shipp's Flash from the 90s is going to be on there.
Jonathan Shakes
as Jonah Hex
is going to be there. Well, that Flash has been on Flash.
Jonah.
So I can't wait for Crisis. Last season of The Flash was so good. It's got me so excited for this.
Talking about Flash a lot. Like, okay, I think I got 6 episodes into the first season. How far do I have to go to care?
Well, first season is very good. It just starts off slow.
The first two seasons are great.
Everyone loves the first season. Especially when you get to like the reveal, it gets really good. The second season was good. The third season, people weren't as excited for. The fourth season was bad. It wasn't good. It's reversed. The third season was bad. The fourth season just wasn't good. The fourth season just wasn't good. But this past season, the fifth season, was fantastic. And I kept telling Devin and Mike to watch it, and they wouldn't watch it.
I watched it.
And then Mike went back and watched it, and he thought it was great, too. Because it was incredible. It was really, really well done, how they did it. And so it's got me super. And Supergirl last season was really good. Like, you would love.
I've heard Supergirl is good, but I just haven't Supergirl, gotten into it.
Especially the last season. They basically turned like the immigrants thing into aliens. And so they had like this guy called like Agent Liberty. And he was basically like a right wing nut job from Fox News who put on a mask and was going out there like terrorizing aliens who have been who they found out were illegal aliens. And so they basically did the whole thing that was happening in real life with immigrants using the aliens as a euphemism. And it was really, really good. And then they had the thing with like Jimmy Olsen, like going to interview them and somebody coming up to him and being like, dude, you can't give them a platform. And he's like, I just want to see where they're coming from. And they're like, you can't give people like that a platform because you basically, by you acknowledging them, is basically like admitting that their point of view has some value and it doesn't. Like, they did all the things that you hear people talk about in real life with this shit. So it was really good. Mm-hmm. Really, really good. But yeah, so Crisis is coming up. The show's start in a couple weeks, the first week of October, which we'll get into later because I have the fall comic book schedule as one of these shows.
But Crisis is not going to happen until the end of the season in May of next year?
No, the mid-season. It's going to happen
mid-season.
Yeah, in December, I think. I think it's November.
Okay.
So the first couple episodes are the last episodes of the first part of the season. And then the second half of Crisis comes back after the break.
I see.
So they're going to leave on a cliffhanger, probably when the Anti-Monitor is destroying everybody. All right.
Should be a good time.
So let's should I go to Marvel, Disney movie? No, you know what? I'll go to a funny story. No, I'll go to gaming news. Let's go to gaming news. Mike, Devin, Sharmane, did you download Mario Kart Tour?
I did.
I don't have those things. I have Xbox. That's what I have.
No, it's on
your iPhone.
iPhone.
Oh, on your phone? Yeah. I didn't even know that was a thing.
It's a new app. It's a Mario Kart app. It's like been this big deal.
No, I don't pay attention to people. No, I have not.
Devin, did you get it?
Nope. I'm jealous because I need somebody to tell me what this Apple Arcade is because I missed everything.
It's not even an Apple Arcade. It's just on the App Store.
Oh. What about Sonic? Sonic's in the App Store too?
I don't know about that. But, yeah, Mike, did you play Mario Kart?
Yeah, I've been playing it a little bit.
What'd you think?
I can't figure out how to steer properly in the drift mode.
Why do you got to do everything difficult? They tell you when you sign up that you can do this regular steering that's easier, or you can do the drift mode. Why wouldn't you start with the normal steering and then go to the drift mode?
I don't know. The drift mode gives you a boost.
Does it? Is that what it does?
Well, if you drift, it gives you can boost. Just like in the normal games. You can't do both at the same time, which is kind of stupid.
Yeah, I like it. It's a cool game. We're going to talk about this in a little bit. It has some microtransactions I haven't felt like I had to do it yet. Says Mario Kart Tour's microtransactions are troubling. Currently, you can buy a pack for $19.99 that includes 45 rubies, which will buy you 10 chances to unlock random drivers and carts. Unlocks Mario as a driver. Feel free to raise an eyebrow over him not being available from the beginning. And 5-star tickets which can be exchanged for the grand stars necessary to continue the campaign. Alternatively, you can pay $4.99 a month to receive assorted goodies, drivers, and carts on a monthly basis. Those prices are way too high. You could quickly reach the cost of Mario Kart 8 Deluxe at that rate. But during my early hours, at least, I did not feel tempted to purchase them, and not just because of the sticker shot. For what it's worth, racing is not limited by a timer, so it was never arbitrarily prevented from playing, and the few races and carts I started with were enough to keep me happy and winning races. So there's a little mixed bag on the microtransactions, which is always a thing when it comes to these mobile games.
Right. Well, I didn't know about them, so I just downloaded them.
But it's free, so yeah. Let's see. That was the other thing. Mario Kart locks the fastest race mode behind a paid subscription. That's what we were just talking about. So, there, you know, it's one of those things. But speaking of microtransactions, I think I saved that. Listen to this one, Mike. A player spent $62,000 in RuneScape, reigniting community anger around microtransactions. $62,000.
Wow. Please, that doesn't surprise me at all.
Controversy over microtransactions is rocking the community of 18-year-old fantasy online role-playing game RuneScape. Criticism of the game's allegedly predatory microtransactions bubbled over after a recent UK Parliament report referenced disordered levels of spending in video games, specifically flagging RuneScape among others. RuneScape players' beef with microtransactions started in 2012 with the game's Squeal of Fortune update, which let players spin a wheel in exchange for armor, money, and experience points. Players could buy the opportunity to spin the wheel, too, with 10 spins going for $4.99 and 200 plus 250 bonus spins going for $99.99. This was met with some severe backlash at the time, said one line-telling RuneScape player who goes by Jake. Mind you, in the beginning, the XP and gold available for purchase through the gambling was completely not worth it and pretty minuscule, but people rightfully were worried for the future. Squeal of Fortune was replaced by Treasure Hunter, which gave players the option to open chests containing random items with keys they earned or purchased. RuneScape once offered a promotion in Treasure Hunter called Prize Pool, which let players gamble on winnings for better prizes at the risk of losing everything. What? Oh, wow. What? After player backlash.
That sounds nuts. Why would anybody play this?
Why would everyone do that? After player backlash, Jagex explained that they let the balance tip too far and promotions seemed to dominate the game, especially when coupled with underwhelming content updates. The prize pool promotion design was misjudged and crossed the line. On top of Treasure Hunter, RuneScape has also offered bonds, a Fortnite-inspired rune pass, and paid features like rune metrics, which let players see gameplay stats, more action bars, and increased bank space. A $10.99 monthly RuneScape membership unlocks quest skills and minigames. This week's flare-up happened after the UK Parliament's September 9 report on immersive and addictive technologies. The report referenced a member of the public whose adult son built up considerable debt, reported to be in excess of 50,000 euros, or $60,000, through spending on microtransactions in British company's Jagex online game RuneScape, which it says caused significant financial harm for both the player and his parents. How do you spend $62,000? How do you have $62,000 to spend on this?
How did he go negative by that much? Wouldn't it get declined?
Unless you just have that kind of money in your account. Jagex told us that it generates about one-third of its revenue from microtransactions and two-thirds coming from an alternative subscription model. I don't know. What are your thoughts on microtransactions? You're a gamer, Sharmane.
I mean, I don't love them. I have sometimes played some of these games that, like, I just get kind of focus and desperate, and I'll end up paying like the, you know, $99 or $1.99 or whatever. I try not to go crazy, but it seems ridiculous because at the end of the day, I'll never know how much I've spent on something. I certainly won't ever spend fucking $60,000 though. That's some craziness. I'm playing a dumb little game right now, just kind of like, it's like a cat tower game. You basically like collect these cats and shit, and it doesn't have any life restrictions, so I don't have anything like that to prevent me. I can keep playing if I want to play, but every now and then it's like, join this $9.99 a month thing and you'll get all this extra stuff, and I'm like, no, I'm not gonna do that. And then it'll say, well, you can't unlock this one thing unless you do that, and I'm like, all right, well, I guess this game has a limit. So for me, I'm not getting fooled into doing that, but I have played games where I've been like, angry and desperate, and I'll pay the stupid $4.99 just to It's happened. I'll admit it's happened. It's like internally embarrassing, but like, you know, nobody knows that you've done this thing or whatever. So
till now.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't like it, but I understand like people need to make their money or whatever, but shit. Like if you could accidentally rack up that kind of money, I don't understand that world. Also, I would really like to create something that would make someone accidentally give me $60,000.
I agree.
Mike, you're probably the biggest gamer on the show. What do you think?
I hate microtransactions. I already paid for the game. Especially in $60 like big titles.
Right.
Right. Like if franchise you do it on the title. On the consoles, that's real frustrating.
Like I already did this. Like I already gave you my money. And now games are not $60 anymore. They're like more.
Mm-hmm.
So like why? Just but here's the charge me I will the say beginning. This:
there's a balance to that because gamers
unless
also, gamers often also want extra content and constant updates and new
okay
and new stuff to pop up and new maps
and with that
new stuff. And
so as long as it doesn't make you better than the other players.
Yes, I agree.
Right, that part. Yeah.
That's it. If it's cosmetic, then go for it.
Yeah, actually, I'm with that. Like, if it's like, I just want this Black Panther suit versus fucking regular-ass clothes, and it's like, I think it's cute, and I'm going to spend that, right. That doesn't bother me. But if it gives somebody an advantage, and I already am not the best gamer on the planet, and I'm also not going to pay $40 for some extra shit, then that's fucking irritating.
So this sounds bullshit, but it says, Jagex said it made a third of its revenue from the 10% of its players who spend money on microtransactions. In April, Jagex announced their highest revenue ever with $115 million made in 2018. Jagex CEO described it as the fourth successive year of significant growth. Mike, have you ever even heard of this game, RuneScape?
I've never heard about it until this day, sir.
Really? It's before never. My time.
Mike, do you know yes. about RuneScape?
Yes.
What is RuneScape? Do you know?
Can
you
it's tell like us? World of Warcraft before World of Warcraft was popular. It's just a big, massive multiplayer online game.
But it's old as hell. Still
I just Googled it and I recognized the image, but I've never played it. I have no idea what kind of gameplay it is.
It was very popular when I was in middle school.
Did you ever play it?
No. I've never been a huge MMO guy. I played the DC Universe MMO.
Mike, I just got DC Universe on Nintendo Switch. I think I'm about to get back to playing it again.
Yo, Brad needs to be a fiend for that shit, yo. But yeah,
we have to play the Star Trek MMO game. It looks so good.
I don't
good.
Like Star Trek, though.
What?
Not like you
I mean,
do.
To be fair, though, he's born after all of the major Star Treks have already been either run and done or far into their run by the time that boy
he's
is born.
He's not born before Discovery, and Discovery is dope as hell.
When did that come out?
Like 2 years.
2 years ago.
Okay, but don't you already have to be?
No,
not,
it's a whole.
Why
different,
would I watch yeah. it?
No, because there's some people that
if
never
you can
watched
love
the
Star
original.
Wars, Mike,
I never watched the original.
If you can love Star Wars, you can love Star Trek. It's the same
thing. Whoa! Did you no, just say you've never watched the original Star Wars?
No, I've seen the original Star Wars.
Oh, okay.
I've seen the original Star Trek.
Okay, well that's fair because there's a lot of people that started in with Next Generation,
Picard, yeah.
and like that's
let me
their
tell you something. None of those version. Original Star Wars movies are better than Next Generation. I'll say it.
Star Trek movie, yeah, yeah.
No, Star Wars movies.
I mean,
oh, okay,
you're crossing
damn.
Streams, though. They're different things. They're not relatable. They're not, I mean, besides the fact that they're sci-fi, there's story-wise, there's not a whole lot of cross. So you can totally be a fan of both things. You
also,
don't have, one is not better than the other.
Also, yeah, also Star Trek, way more diverse than Star Wars.
Always.
True. There are actually
way more
people
liberal,
of color in the universe.
And the stories, except for that one racist episode, we need to review that on the show. It is hilarious.
The samurai one or the...
I haven't got... to, oh, the samurai one's pretty bad, too. I have seen that one. But the one where they go to the black people planet and then they make the two women fight for the honor of the king, it's like super, it's pretty bad.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't think I've gotten to that one.
It's in the first season of the Next
So
Generation.
We tried to rewatch them and we've gotten like partway through the second... Oh, it's... Oh, Next Generation. No.
Generation.
Yeah, I never watched that.
Yeah. It's pretty
I watched
bad.
Some of of it when it was on.
But Star Wars.
But like the original, though, the original Star Trek series integrated TV. It was the first on-screen interracial kiss. There was also the first time a Japanese person was a main character. Like, they've done some significant things for TV and for sci-fi and stuff like that. That Star Wars
that
for
was
sure
in an internment camp.
You're right.
That's how right. Like that's crazy to think about it. But he was in an internment camp when he was a child. George Takei. So yeah, Star Trek's dope. I love Star Trek. And I'm watching Discovery now, and it's fucking great.
I haven't seen Discovery yet because I don't get that CBS.
Oh, I'll hook
you All up. Access, don't do it. Don't do it. Yeah.
I'll hook you
up. Brandon likes Twilight Zone and shit. Twilight Zone's good too.
And
services.
Picard is about to come back.
But see, like, at this point, I used to complain that I had cable and it was so expensive. Now I don't have cable, but I got what?
1,000 streaming services?
some of the services... As I share with people, but like HBO, Showtime, the Hulu and the Netflix and all that kind of stuff. Now we're gonna have Marvel or Disney Plus coming up. Like this is getting.
I'm just gonna cancel everything when Disney Plus comes out.
No, you're not.
Not canceling Hulu. I'm not.
No, Hulu is part of the Disney Plus.
See,
free. There's a free part of it.
If you get Disney Plus a particular level, you'll get Hulu included. It'll be Hulu without the. With the commercials,
with the ads, no.
Oh, so you want to? You'd rather pay? Oh,
see, for
me,
it would be really hard to give up HBO or not HBO, Netflix. But I can.
No, go ahead, Sharmane. Hello. We're back again. I'm not doing no editing, but we keep having dropouts, so y'all had to deal with that. But I assume y'all had a nice conversation while I was fixing my shit.
Sure. We talked about streaming services.
I was gonna say, Devin, if you willing to pay fucking $11 extra to save 7 minutes of commercials, you're drunk.
And the thing is, it's not even saving commercials because, like, if you watch Fox shows, the shit was like all the other things that you pay for is commercial free, except for this one show that you're watching.
Agents of Shield too.
Agents of Shield. It, like the only shows I watch on, I paid $11. The only shows I watch are ones that they just so happen to still air commercials on. I'm like, what the fuck am I paying for here?
Fuck that.
In the beginning. So I mean, like, I'm okay with it.
And you can watch more sports, Devin, when you're on the plane and shit in hotels on ESPN Plus.
That's true. But, I mean, I got, you know, my parents got DirecTV, so
ESPN Plus ain't part of DirecTV.
I know, but I'm just saying, like, I get a lot of that shit anyway, so, like, sure, I really need to see.
No, you need to get to Disney Plus. Just stop being fucking stupid.
Oh, I'm getting Disney Plus, though.
All right, last gaming news. GameStop announced it will be closing 180 to 200 underperforming stores. Who's shocked?
I worked at a GameStop for 9 days as an assistant manager before I quit.
9 days?
Okay, can we get the story behind that shit? Like, what made you quit?
Basically, like, there was just no training, and then one day I get told I'm opening the next day, and I'm like, but you've not shown me the system, the computer system, or anything like that. Who else is going to be with me? They're like, nobody. And I'm like, all right, so I don't know how to ring up anybody on your particular system. I have not clocked in and clocked out myself, and the only thing I do know how to do is turn on and off the alarm system. That's all I've learned in 9 days.
Wow.
You sure you're not going to send me somebody? And they're like, no. And then I was 7 hours into the shift, and it was like, you're still supposed to do like your 9 hours or whatever, but I was 7 hours into my shift and the next person was not going to be coming in for like 4 more hours. So I was trying to do that math, like, wait a second, I'm supposed to be working a 9 hour day. That extra 4 hours is going to put me over.
Where are you working?
This was GameStop in Massachusetts.
Oh, I thought this was a, you have
it. No, this is
God
years
damn it,
ago.
Michael. God
this
damn it,
years
Michael.
Years ago. Years ago. I worked there for 9 days and I quit after 9 days. This is one of the few times I like quit without. I was like, I'm out. This is nothing you guys promised me. I'm out. And I had to like change my hair from purple back to natural for it and shit like that. It was
really?
Like, yeah.
Again, we're back. keep fucking up. I think non-ghost believing Sharmane put a hex on us.
It sounds right.
That's what happens when you don't believe in ghosts.
Why are you always blaming me for shit, Brandon?
Nah, this shit ain't real.
The internet ghost says Sharmane don't believe in me, so I'm gonna show y'all.
Wow. Look, whose internet got shut down though, fool? Not mine.
Yeah, no. See, that's what happens. This internet, this ghost takes it out on your friends, not you, to make you
feel
worse. Stupid.
Like, no, it's real.
Smart dude, you should know better than this.
No, Sharmane, you're the only jinx that happened here because you talk that shit, and we never have problems with the internet.
Okay, I'm the only jinx, and yet me, who actually had internet problems earlier today where part of my building went down, is not
you
had a single
them on, you
internet.
Passed them on to the podcast. Oh. Just saying.
See, I get invited to be a guest on this show, and this is how I get treated.
That's right.
You wonder why I ain't been around for months, but you know, whatever.
All right, so the comic book, I got the comic book TV schedule for this fall, so we're going to find out what everyone's interested in. So currently airing, we have DuckTales Season 2. Has anybody watched the new DuckTales?
Yes, it's great. That's great. It's really good.
Is it good?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Huey and Dewey, they have a mom. You find out who their mom is, where Donald is still around. Scrooge is great. Launchpad is great.
It's already on?
Yeah. Season 1's already been out. It's like 20-something episodes. It's really good. And then the nanny, she has a bigger role, and she's like MI6 agent or some shit like that. And then Webby's back. So, yeah, it's really good. I like it.
All right. What about the news? The Spider-Man show on Disney XD. Have you watched that, Devin?
I've watched maybe like 12 episodes. It's really good, though. It's really good. I just haven't had time when I'm at my parents' house to watch it, but it's really good. It's well done. They stick more to young Peter Parker, and it's really good. He's still at City High? What is it? What's the high school? He's at his high school. So yeah. That's where it's at.
Did you guys know they brought back Ripley's Believe It or Not?
Yeah, I'm pass for me.
On the Travel Channel.
That's a pass for me.
I used to watch that shit all the time. The first time.
Dean Cain was great. Dean Cain was good.
He's trash, but he's a trash human being. But it was good.
I saw him on the Paramount lot one year when I was on the lot. He's just walking around out of his trailer.
Has anyone watched Pennyworth?
No.
I was waiting for you, Brandon.
I'm thinking about watching it, but I have not started it. I want to watch like one episode to see what it's about, but also like what Pennyworth are we getting? Are we getting like mercenary Pennyworth?
Yes, this is young Alfred MI6 agent.
Meets Thomas Wayne and shenanigans occur.
I'll watch an episode. I haven't yet, but I'll watch an episode.
I feel like you can't watch an episode. I feel like you have to watch like at least 3 or 4 episodes.
I don't know, because like I watched Pennyworth Patrol and I only got partway through it before I got bored.
The new trailer for the seasons of Arrow and Flash just dropped. Forget Pennyworth.
Okay, Mike, wait a second. Okay, we're going in chronological order. Mike, can you give us an update on Titans?
I watched that third episode. It wasn't nearly. It wasn't.
Is it season 2 already?
Yeah, yes. They didn't make him out to be. They didn't paint it as if he was a killer. That article was misleading. Watch it. They didn't say anything about.
What do you mean? The quote
that
was
quote never happened. That quote is not in there.
You're lying.
I watched it.
You weren't paying attention.
I was paying attention.
Mike, you were not paying attention. I don't. Sharmane literally. No, Sharmane told you about the time she worked at GameStop, and you really was like, "What are you talking about?" Okay.
So he hesitated to make a movie in general. He didn't hesitate to kill anybody. And then Hank was like, the old Robin wouldn't have hesitated. That's all he said.
That means the old Robin would have killed him.
No, he meant like he didn't do anything. He literally just sat there. He didn't do anything. He didn't try and stop him at all. That whatever we were talking about last time was horribly.
That's exactly what we were talking about. By Hank saying the old Robin wouldn't have hesitated is admitting that the old Robin would have killed him.
No. No, yes. He didn't do anything.
I didn't even watch it, and I'm already telling you that's the correct thing.
He doesn't. It's not implied that he was a murderer at all. I already watched it.
So why did he say the old Robin wouldn't have hesitated?
Because
that's a murder comment.
When Dr. Light was like attacking everybody, Robin had an opportunity to jump and try and stop him, but he just sat behind a car door.
And stop him how?
With his fit. He didn't have anything. He didn't do anything. He literally just didn't move.
I'm going to need a judge's ruling on this one.
I'm not watching that shit-ass show. Can't believe Mike's watching. Mike, you can keep giving us a report.
I told you I only got 1 minute and 11 seconds into the first episode of season 1. I was like, I'm good. I saw everything I need to know. If I go into my DC app right now and load up Titans, it's going to be at the 1 minute, 11 second mark.
Do you know how angry a show has to be for me not to watch a show with Nightwing in it? I saw a set photo of him in his suit. And I said, there's Nightwing on live action television, and I'm not watching it. That's how bad it is.
That's got to be a pretty,
not bad. Yeah. You're all just terrible people.
How far did you get, Brandon?
I watched the whole first season.
Oh, you did?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I like to torture myself.
I mean,
the cliffhanger,
no justice, though.
The cliffhanger of that third episode is Deathstroke kidnapping Jason Todd because Jason was being an idiot. It's so good.
Jason Todd has also always
been an idiot.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, but Dick was like, Jason,
not to victim blame or
Jason
anything,
was but... like, so like, basically right now what's happening is Dick has the old, the new Teen Titan, like the Teen Titans, like Beast Boy, Raven, Jason, and I guess, I don't know if Rose,
Starfire.
Wilson, well, Starfire is, I would consider it like she's with the older people. Okay. So like, and then, but she's doing some Tamaranian stuff, so she's not even in this part of the story right now. And then there's Hank, Hawk and Dove, Donna Troy, and then Nightwing. And he was like, Jason was like, let me help. And he was like, no, you're not ready for Dr. Light. Let us handle this. And so they're looking for him, and Jason finds him, and he's like, I'm gonna, you know, Jason and Beast Boy find him on the computer, like using the like whatever they were doing to find him. And then Jason goes after him. Oh, I'm gonna prove to Dick that I can hang with him.
See,
and then
what is wrong with the Bat family? Why do they always have to prove to one of the other members that they're worth it?
Jason goes in like he gets his ass beat by Dr. Light, but at the end he like beats the shit out of Dr. Light, like he's like beating him senseless, and then Deathstroke just shows up and kidnaps Jason. It was pretty cool. Jason's a little too violent, I think, even for Jason.
I realized that Jason Todd wasn't that violent, right?
I know. I just said Jason's a little too violent, but
you realize that's ridiculous. They're making him Red Hood before Red Hood.
Right.
Like, it's ridiculous.
Yeah. Like, he needs to be triggered by the events of that to be, like, why do they jump? Because whatever. I'm not watching it.
In the pilot, Hawk and Dove, I guess, or when Dove is in a coma at the end of the first season, and she, like, wakes up, and I guess right as she woke up, she had a vision of, like, Wayne Manor, and so she's like, we gotta go find Batman, and then they get there, and Jason Todd is driving a motorcycle through Wayne Manor's staircase, and they're like, what the fuck is going on? And
please,
he's like,
talking about that trash shit. What the fuck, man?
He was like, Jason was like, who the fuck are you guys?
I can't wait for Young Justice to come back.
Like,
that's gonna be great. Like,
how do you, who,
that's
why
a,
are you?
Yeah, Blur Vision, like, keeps trying to get me to watch it. I ain't watched it
yet.
Oh
yeah, Young Justice is great.
That's great. But they were like, we're the type of people that know about the big, scary cave downstairs. And he was like, well, Batman's not here. He's with the Justice League.
Oh, my God.
It's all so right. Good.
October 6th, Batwoman, season 1. Devin, are
gotta
you
watch. You gotta watch it. It's because of the crossover episode last year.
Was she on another show?
They did a crossover to introduce her, and then this is the first season of her getting her own show.
So
I'm gonna watch it just to see, you know, just like I want to see
her,
it for
her.
We'll see. Like, amazing. I don't think she's that good of an actress, but I think she is. I think she's well casted for, like, you know,
W show.
Mild, like, personality-less lesbian.
And I
want to
see if,
like,
they go there.
It works for her.
I want to see if they go there with her.
Oh, is she not going to be a lesbian?
No, she is a lesbian, but I want to see if they go all the way there. Like, you know, in the comic books, right, they were going to have her be the first lesbian, the first gay marriage, and then DC ixnayed that because they thought it was too controversial. Like, the writer had everything planned out for her to marry her girlfriend and have the first gay marriage. This was around the time when gay marriage got approved, or right before it got approved. I mean, right before it got passed, and DC was like, nah, we're not doing that. So, we'll see how far the show goes with that.
I mean, I hope they do. Like, at this point, it's silly for us not to acknowledge that this is the fucking way of life. Like, let it fucking happen. But yeah, like, I think in terms of how they casted her, I think she's done really shit. Like, that's her personality. She's that kind of like deadpan.
Well, in Arrow, yeah, they have a gay marriage. Well, they had one. I think he got divorced. Wasn't Mr. Terrific married to his husband?
They got a divorce.
Yeah, I think they got a divorce. And Supergirl Alex, I think they're trying to make Alex bisexual. I don't know. I can't tell. I really can't tell. I don't want.
They wanted to make her bisexual, but then like, yeah, I think she's just gay.
I know. Well, hold on. I know that White Canary is bisexual. She's fully bisexual.
That I think I heard.
Cause she will.
She's great.
She's fucking great on that show, Legends of Tomorrow. She don't give a fuck. Supergirl comes back October 6th. Season 5 of Supergirl. I'm excited for that. Season 3 of Black Lightning. I think Stephanie wants to give it another chance.
Somebody we know said that the trailer was amazing.
Good. Yeah, Rasani.
Wade said that, but he liked the season 2 too. So I don't know how to take that.
Oh.
Season 2 was trash. Made us quit reviewing it.
Yeah, we just quit. Yeah.
We had fun season 1 reviewing it. Season 2,
not so much.
Flash comes back October 8th. So this all come back in the next couple weeks.
I mean, when did the season start getting so late? It used to be that this shit started right around the time school got in. But
no, it's usually like, it's like around the 27th. They would have been coming back around the last weekend, September.
Arrow's final season, season 8, it's only 10 episodes, so that starts later in October 15th. The Watchmen season 1 starts October 20th. Mike, are you excited for the TV show The Watchmen?
Yeah, but I don't have HBO.
Well, we'll find a way to get that.
Between us, yeah, we'll figure it out.
Because I don't have HBO either, but I'm watching.
I forget. Are they doing some kind of a reimagination, right? So
it's the same universe, but present day.
Yeah, I think it's like 20 years later.
Brandon hasn't read Watchmen, though, so he doesn't even know what's going on.
So when we jump into the world, though, are we jumping in the world post-book? So if we know the book, we're good?
Yeah, it's post-book.
The book takes place in, like, the 70s.
Yeah, I know.
It's post-book.
I've read it.
You read it. You're cultured, unlike Brandon.
And I heard that Dr. Manhattan shows up.
He very well could.
Really?
No, I heard he was in the trailer. Or they said something
about
the trailer.
Who have they casted for him?
I don't know.
You can cast anybody as him. I mean, he's just a blue man
with a nice body. You gotta have.
Yeah, but like, body. I mean, we've already seen Billy Crudup as him. So, are they gonna do that, or are they just acting like that didn't happen?
I don't know if they're going with the movie happened or not.
Have different actors. So, but I don't know. But the movie is just a retelling of the book. I heard it was just it's just a shot. It looks like it's just. I mean, the movie is just a shot by shot from the book, essentially.
Yeah,
the movie we already saw.
Yeah,
No. Zack they Snyder changed did. The whole ending and everything.
They kind of did.
No,
they
didn't. I'm talking about this a panel by panel retelling of the story,
like, with the exception of the ending. She's right.
With the exception of the ending.
Well, I haven't read the ending of the book, but I know what I've read so far.
It's drastically like the movie ending and the book ending is drastically different.
Okay. So I'm reading that now. I forget how far I've been into it. My comic book app on the iPad tells me what percentage I've read of each book, and it says I've read 24%. So I'm 24%
into it. Wait a minute. I gave you a hard copy of it.
I know, but I already packed it for my move. I've packed my comic books already, Mike.
December, when are you moving?
November 1st, in a month.
I'll help you, buddy.
December 13th is The Runaway Season 3. Devin, you excited for that?
Oh, yeah, definitely. It's a great show. And we're getting a Cloak and Dagger appearance this season, so it should be cool.
The Harley Quinn animated show comes out on DC Universe sometime before the end of the year. Sharmane, are you excited for that?
I mean, I don't know much about it specifically, but I knew it's coming, and I love everything Harley Quinn anyway. So.
And DC animation is always great.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, and I just, like, a couple weeks ago, we ran through all of the Batman movies again, all the animated Batman movies, and we even dabbled into some of the Superman movies, even though I think Superman's a joke, but...
Trash. You know. He's trash.
So the show's going to follow...
I'm looking forward to it.
Okay, the premise of the show is Harley Quinn follows Harley Quinn's adventures after she breaks up with the Joker including receiving help from Poison Ivy and others.
Damn, put your mute on. Just chewing.
Oh, yeah. So it follows her after she broke up with the Joker. It's basically going to be her and Poison Ivy running around doing shit.
But are they going to be together? Like, that's, I mean, I know it's an animated thing, but is it like...
Well, in the books, they're not technically together. Like, I've read the whole New 52 Harley Quinn, and she wasn't, like...
It wasn't explicit.
Yeah, it was kind of ambiguous in a way.
I think I'm getting my porn confused with reality of the books.
But they said they're doing so Cyborgman, Dr. Psycho, Malice, King Shark, Clayface are all
nice.
Reported to be in the show. Kaylee Kukau, that's not how you say her name, Kukau from Big Bang Theory is playing Harley
Quinn. Oh, she's going to voice Harley?
Yeah, she's voicing Harley Quinn.
Hmm. And is she gonna voice her with the accent, or is she gonna
get
her own
know.
Interpretation?
I don't know.
I don't like when they don't have Harley with a Jersey accent.
They have Lake Bell, who I don't know, but she's doing.
Oh, she's Ivy. Funny. She's doing Ivy.
She's doing Ivy.
Mm-hmm. So she's got a raspy, kind of a husky voice, and I think that works for Ivy.
Oh, they got Deidre. Hold up. Diedrich Bader's doing Batman?
Yes, so we didn't talk about this before.
What?
Remember when they started releasing that shit? They talked about him and everybody was like, who? Like, everybody thought, you mean Riddler, right? And they're like, no.
Diedrich Bader's doing Batman? I cannot believe that.
It's not good.
Do you know who that is, Devin? Devin.
He's on mute because he's eating.
Yeah, I do not know who that is. Who
do
is
you
that?
Remember Napoleon Dynamite?
Yes.
Remember the guy who played Rex from Rex Kwando?
Yes.
He's like, this is Rex Kwando.
And he was on
And he was on the Drew Carey show.
I know what he's talking about. Yeah, yeah.
He's playing he's gonna be the voice of Batman.
That's gonna be great. It's animated, so it's gonna be great.
No, animation acting, voice acting is a fucking art. You can't just like roll in and be like, I'm Batman or some bullshit.
Does voice acting though.
I know, but does he do bat? Like, I don't know.
Jim Rash is doing the Riddler.
Who is?
Jim Rash. He was known as Dean Craig Pelton on The Community.
Yeah. I actually love this guy. Like, he's gonna be fantastic
as Joker.
He's got talent that, like, people, I don't think, credit him as hard. Doesn't he do some other voices on some of the animated things?
I believe so. A lot of the villains, a lot of the, like, the
core. Hey, yo, JB Smoove's gonna be on there.
Nice. Who's he playing?
He's playing Frank the Plant. Oh, Jason Alexander. Oh, that is perfect casting.
For a Penguin?
He's doing Cyborgman. If you Google Cyborgman, and then you look up Jason, he's from the comic books. If you Google Cyborgman, and then you see that's going to be Jason Alexander, you're going to be like, that's perfect. Wanda Sykes is doing Queen of Fables.
Wow, that's crazy. DC casting is really fantastic. So,
they're animated stuff. They don't mess around.
I cannot wait to hear Jason Alexander Cyborgman. That's gonna be fucking fantastic.
Because the way he complains, yeah, you're right. I got it.
All
right,
so yeah, I'm excited.
When's that come out?
Probably sometime before the end of the year.
Okay.
They haven't given a date yet. It says tentatively been scheduled to DC to release mid-October to early November. So sometime around then. They did a teaser trailer. Oh, October 3rd, ahead of the annual New York Comic Con, a teaser trailer featuring Harley Quinn, Poison Ivy, and Batman was released. A full uncensored trailer set to Joan Jett's cover of the theme song from the Mary Tyler Moore Show was released July 20th, 2019, to coincide with San Diego Comic Con. So you can watch the trailers there. Tisha Campbell Martin's in there, too, and Phil Lamar. So they got a lot of people for that show. And then 2020, we got Legends of Tomorrow coming back. We have the new the reboot of the Boondocks. Season 2 of Doom Patrol, which I can't wait for. Falcon and Winter Soldier, Disney Plus. Stargirl on DC Universe. Ghost in the Shell TV series. What do you think about that, Sharmane? Are they going to get it right?
That long sigh.
Are they going to get it right on the TV series? It's on Netflix.
I mean, well, see, but Netflix fucks up, though, because, like, Netflix made a live action of, I'm blanking all of a sudden, Death Note, that was trash. Like, you know, like, they, I can't say that Netflix can be trusted for this, for that. Like,
it depends who does it. Are they going to get Japanese, you know, actors?
We're talking about a live action, right?
They're not gonna. Didn't Death Note, or they have some, Netflix has some properties that do anime live actions with Japanese actors.
They do get Japanese actors, and then they voice them. They do the dub voice situation or whatever, which I don't like. I prefer to, if I'm gonna watch it, I prefer to watch it in Japanese. Like, if you watch the Death Note, it's trash.
Never,
like,
gave it a chance.
It's so bad. I mean, even, like, the Japanese live actions aren't great all the way through, but they have moments of, like, yes, I know where you're mm-hmm. getting this from, everything, whatever, blah, blah, blah. I don't trust it. And honestly, like, I don't need it, too. Like, they can just leave it alone. They fucked up once. They don't need to be like, my bad. Let me try this again. Just leave it alone.
But there's so many iterations of Ghost in the Shell. So, I mean, you got to.
But, like, the first one is what you need.
Yeah, facts.
That's it. Like, the first one is what you need. And honestly, like, I'm not.
And speaking of TV shows, I know Mike's going to be a little disappointed, but.
I know.
They canceled Ghost Rider. Well, it's not moving forward.
I'm not happy about that either.
Oh, that's right. You did watch Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So, yeah, the Robbie Reyes Ghost Rider show that was supposed to happen on Hulu, they basically had a creative impasse, and the show is no longer moving forward.
See, that, like, given how excited people were about it, this shit is starting to drive me nuts when it's like the internal politics of the studios can't get it right. And we've already told you there's a demand out here. You've teased it. We're excited. Don't tell me you can't agree on some fucking shit. Like, make it happen for us. That's bullshit. So it's not even up for grabs. Like, Disney Plus can't grab it or anything. Maybe. Like that. It's just dead.
But they just had a creative impasse. So they're not going forward with it, at least through Hulu at this point.
I really liked that dude's portrayal on Agents.
Yeah, he was really good.
He was dope. And I'm not happy that they're doing this.
In other Marvel news, Disney news, Kevin Feige is developing a Star Wars movie.
Okay, come through.
I'm excited about that.
Yeah, I'll watch it.
Well, you're going to watch it anyway. Now, there's some people. Then you got the rumors because the Dude Bros hate Kathleen Kennedy. And so they've been telling you for years that she's been gone and Disney hates her. And so now people are like, is Marvel going to lose Kevin Feige to Star Wars? And is he going to take over for Kathleen Kennedy? None of that's going to happen. I'm telling you that right now. That's not happening. Kevin Feige probably just said, I want to do a Star Wars film. And Disney said, you've made us billions of dollars. Go ahead, brother. Do whatever the fuck you want.
I agree with that.
He's going to get a chance to make a Star Wars film. And given his track record, I'm pretty sure it'll be good.
Have they determined what, like, is he going to dip back into the Skywalkers or is he going a different way? Because at this point, we need them to go a different way.
Well, yeah, I think this is the last movie of the Skywalkers.
It's called The Rise of the Skywalkers.
I think that's done to mislead you. That's all I will say. I am ready for the Skywalkers to be done. I'm sick. I'm not going to say I'm sick of the Skywalkers, but I'm ready for that.
Like, we don't need to dip into that well. Like,
the world is so big. There's so,
yeah,
the stuff, the one,
there's no other families of significance.
Yeah, one of the good things that I liked most about what was the Last Jedi was the scene at the end of the film where they were going throughout the universe and showing all these different people in the universe
and the kids. Yeah,
and I'm like, the world of Star Wars is so much bigger than these few planets that we always go to in this one family. So start telling these other stories. I want to see
stories. Our cats are all named for Star Wars Extended Universe characters. Like, the Extended Universe is so thick with possibilities.
Doesn't exist in this canon, at least.
Yeah, that drives me nuts. Like, I mean,
But
if you read the Heir to the Empire books, how they decided not to go that route, like you already had a story that fans have just loved as a next in line trilogy or whatever, and then to do away with that and say, you know, oh my bad, Thrawn is not a thing anymore.
No, Thrawn is still a thing though.
Yeah, but they canceled him in the original canon decision, and then they brought him back because people got upset. But what they did with that is when the way they brought him back, and because of the movies, they canceled his involvement in Leia and the Solo twins and all this other kind of stuff. So like there's a version of what should have happened after the original movies where the Solo twins and Mary Jane, like there's all these characters that people have been in love with. And when they reimagined their canon, they took that away. And Thrawn, I never say his name right. Yeah. Thrawn. He's just such a good he's such a good stoic villain.
That's what Mike and Devin keep telling me.
Yeah, he's like, oh gosh, I think I might have the Heir to the Empire trilogy on my Audible if you want to audiobook it. I have all the books though. I have the trilogy books if you ever get so inclined. It's such a good trilogy. It'll make you so angry that these new movies exist.
Oh wow.
Because the way the next generation was gonna start, like, yeah, I'm mad.
Well, here's the thing. I'm the opposite of that because I read the Star Wars comic books, and they're trying to build up a universe through that. And I haven't watched Rebels, but from what everyone tells me, that is great.
Yeah, everybody says Rebels pretty good. I haven't seen it, but people.
Mike and Devin.
Clone Wars is coming back too, baby.
Clone Wars is coming back. They're doing these TV shows on Disney Plus. I think they're going to rebuild this. And here's the thing. I actually think that TV show Star Wars can be really, really good if they take the time to do it. Because given something like that, 13 episodes or 18 episodes, however many they decide to do on different Star Wars series, you can really explore a lot of things that you don't really get a chance to in a 2.5-hour movie. And so I think they can really expand this universe if they do it properly. And if they kind of do it by integrating, they said that the animated show is a part of canon now too. So if they use animated shows and these live action shows to expand the universe, I think that they can do a good job. But Kevin Feige, yeah, go ahead, brother. I mean, I have no reason to think it's going to be bad based on you haven't given me a bad film. There's been not great Marvel films, but I haven't seen a bad film. There's no Green Lantern. There's no Suicide Squad.
Right. The worst MCU movie is not even close to the best non-MCU Marvel movies.
The worst MCU movies is just an okay movie in general. It's just like, okay, that movie was okay. There are no bad movies. So I have little to doubt that if Kevin Feige's producing or developing a Marvel film, I mean a Star Wars film, that it won't be pretty damn good. I got some funny news. Oh, this is before Mike's time, so this is for mostly Sharmane and Devin.
mostly for the old ass of the group, Sharmane.
Jason Bateman is eyed to direct the new Clue film starring Ryan Reynolds.
Nope.
I mean, okay, I have a love affair with the movie Clue. I actually recently watched it. Like, it is one of my favorite movies. Ryan Reynolds is one of my favorite white people. Jason Bateman, I think, would be the right guy to direct it, given what he's doing now. Like, I think he's got the right cadence for that kind of thing.
Definitely.
I don't know, like, is Ryan supposed to play the Tim Curry character?
I'm gonna see Fox. Is he?
I can't figure out a character that Ryan Reynolds fits in.
The Clue reboot was announced when Reynolds hot off the success of Deadpool movie signed a 3-year first look deal with Fox. Reynolds was starring and produced the pick through his Maximum Effort banner along with Hasbro's All Spark Pictures. Bateman would also appear in the film. Rhett Reese and Paul Wernick, who wrote the Deadpool films, were set to write the screenplay when the project was first announced. Bateman, who also set to direct episodes of the upcoming HBO series The Outsiders. So it doesn't say who he's playing, but I would assume it would be the Tim Curry character.
See, I don't love him for the Tim Curry character, but the Tim Curry character is the major dude, so I don't know. I love the movie. I love Clue, though. I had like I have nothing against.
I like even, the movie. Yeah,
Mike, have you ever seen the movie Clue?
No.
Mike's on mute.
Me? I've seen the board game.
So you know what a board game is?
yes, I know what a board game is, Brandon.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Brandon.
So yeah, I'm excited. I love Clue. I'm like Sharmane.
I love Clue. I wouldn't mind them finding other like fun little ways of having Clue be a thing. I love Ryan Reynolds. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see if he can pull. Well, the problem is it's gonna be the audience thing, because for me, I'm gonna have a hard time separating Tim Curry out of that role. Like, he is so perfect in that role.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like, it would be hard for me to separate him. And, that cast was so brilliant.
I may watch Clue this weekend just to talk about this. I'm
like,
excited.
Dude, I watched it, like, a month ago. Like, seriously, I fucking love that movie. I can't think, like, are they going to update it to, like, what's going on in our world versus the, because, like, the Red Scare thing is going to miss a whole bunch of people. Yeah. Like, I'm from that era, so I remember the Cold War and all that kind of stuff or whatever. Even though that their version of it was like 30 years before my version, we still had the Red Scare. We were still afraid of Russians right. And communists back then. That's not really going to translate today.
All right, two more stories. Jeffrey Dean Morgan, the actor who plays Negan on The Walking Dead, is taking shots at Dwayne The Rock Johnson. Jeffrey Dean Morgan says, "I'm more of a man than The Rock could ever be."
Wow. Why? Are they going to do a movie together and this is some kind of publicity
stunt? Well,
they
did Rampage together.
Oh, I've missed Rampage.
Morgan and Johnson started
Rampage together. No, you didn't miss anything.
Becoming close pals throughout production, often interacting in front of social media. After covering Hobson's show in Hawaii with Johnson, complete with a celebratory shot of tequila, I posed a similar opportunity for Morgan's celebration of The Walking Dead's 10th season. After downing a shot of Jack Daniel's whiskey on the red carpet, Morgan found out The Rock sipped some Don Julio at the Hobbs & Shaw event and left a bit in the glass. This prompted what might just launch an all-out war. I'm more of a man than The Rock ever could be.
It's silly.
So that's it good. Says, in a fight, who do you have, Negan or Luke Hobbs?
Luke Hobbs all day. He's a superhero. Yeah.
I don't know. Negan with that bat.
Fuck that bat, yo. This nigga beat up a cyborg, yo. A half human.
I mean.
Black Superman. Excuse me.
Did he actually beat him up, or did he get his ass whipped and then got lucky?
I mean, they used teamwork to beat him, but I'm still saying, like.
I mean, they didn't really beat him. He beat himself, to be honest.
And he lost, and then they killed him. Yeah, yeah. You're right. Yeah.
All right, Mike, get off of mute and come back for this one, because I know where you're going to stand on this. But we have to end it on a robot story.
Yes!
NASA is working on Transformers-like shape-shifting robots.
Yes!
What?
Yes! Let's do it! Yes! I need one. Where do I get one? I'm going to have to call my friend. He works there.
This is not a good idea!
This is.
What do you mean it's a great idea?
It's fun! Don't take away my Transformers.
Megatron's running around this fucking world. I don't.
I do.
Okay, but so you're thinking about sentient. They're just talking about making transforming vehicles. Right.
I just want to hit a button in my transform into something else.
What's the logical next step after you pull that off?
Yes. What's the logical next step?
But I'm still here for it. Let's go.
I would like a Transformer that is not sentient so that I can control it and show it off to all my friends.
Let me dig back into some childhood memories. There are regular Transformer robots that switch between humanoid and vehicle form, and then there are Transformers with independent components that can mesh together into a single machine. NASA is developing a robot concept similar to the latter option with its shape-shifting project. NASA shared a look at 3D-printed prototype shapeshifter on Wednesday, describing it as a contraption that looks like a drone encased in an elongated hamster wheel. The machine is in a testing at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory Robotics Yard in Pasadena, California. The Robotics Yard is a dusty place designed to challenge machines that may encounter rugged conditions on other planets and moons. The current shapeshifter test version has two halves that split apart and can fly as aerial drones, or they can combine together and roll along the ground. The shapeshifter team has Saturn's moons in mind for the robot. NASA already has plans to send a rotorcraft, basically a large drone, to Saturn's moon Titan with the Dragonfly mission planned for 2026.
Thanos is going to see it.
A more advanced version of the shapeshifter would consist of a group of smaller robots called Cobots. The Cobots could move independently but also work together.
They got the mini bots.
Difficult terrain, explore caves, swim, and even relocate a mothercraft lander from one place to another. Shapeshifter is in a very early stages of development as part of NASA's Innovative Advanced Concepts program. The Shapeshifter team plans to apply for more NASA funding in 2020 to continue work on the project.
All for it. How do I get a job there?
Mike, come on. Now this, if you're just sending these to other planets, I'm okay.
You don't mind colonialism as long as it's on other planets?
I don't want to colonize the planet. I just want to see what's there.
We're going to weaponize it. Let's do it.
No, let's not do it.
I don't want to weaponize it because when they weaponize things, they send them to brown places and kill people. I'm not okay with that. But
the idea is that Saturn's moon Titan has a top shelf of glass, and then under that is an ocean of water.
That's awesome.
Like actual H2O water. So,
water.
What are the odds that they go there and they drill through the ice and they find living aquatic life?
I mean, why not? Why would we be the only things? That's silly.
Now here's another thing about life, because we always get talking about aliens. Would it be weirder or would it make more sense if we found life that looked like us on other planets?
I think it would be weirder.
Weirder, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't want that.
Because that would indicate that there's something about a humanoid shape or whatever that is like the way life goes.
What about with animals? Like, what if they go to Titan and they go under the ice and they see things that look like whales or, some type of shark or something?
I mean, I think anything that resembles anything we have on this planet would be strange. I think it would be just something different. Because also think about like the density and different things that you're dealing with a lot of these different planets and moons. They say that if humans actually were to go colonize Mars, after several generations, they would develop these really skinny waists and these really barrel chests.
The Expanse, Sharmane.
Okay, so
you gotta watch The Expanse.
I think it would be weird if things looked like us. If we went to
they're not gonna be anything that looks like us in our solar system, because the farther away you get, your body evolves and adapts to change over time. So it's way colder over there. So they're not gonna look like us. They would have thicker coats of fur to keep them warm. And sea creatures, if you're only talking sea creatures, I mean, things that can survive in that harsh of an environment don't even exist on this planet, so they're not going to look anything like anything.
How do you know it's that harsh of an environment?
I mean, we got some weird looking shit when you go down into the deep sea.
Where would the source of heat be?
The sun?
The sun is far away. It's closer to us. It's warmer.
They don't
here.
Have a core? You're going to say that their planet doesn't have a core?
We would know. I mean, then it would steam. Then the ice would have melted.
We have a core, and our ice doesn't melt from below.
Duh, Mike.
I mean, they have moons, so they have cycles of days or whatever. So, like,
but those days are going to be much colder than our days.
But is the warmest part of Titan colder than the coldest part of Earth? That's the question.
Probably. We're so far away. You know how far away we are? You know how long it would take you 7 years to get to Titan?
No, not 7 years.
You want a bet?
I don't think it'll take 7 years.
Isn't it 3 years to Mars?
No, it's not 3 years to Mars.
No.
I don't think it's 3 years to Mars. Let me see. How long did
I think it is
take the Mars rover to get to Mars? It took the Mars rover 8.5 months.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Why did I think 3 years? That's been stuck in my head for a long time.
And so as
maybe
we develop
way
more
back
technology, we probably can get to Mars in like 6 months. In the next few years, if we keep developing technology. And so if we get to Mars in 6 months, you probably get to Saturn in what, double that time, maybe?
No, it's exponentially farther.
Is it exponentially farther?
Have you ever seen a map of the solar system?
Let me see the map of the solar system. How far? Let's see this. This is great podcasting.
It took Pioneer 11 6.5 years to reach. I'm sorry. Pioneer 11 took 6.5 years to arrive to Saturn. Voyager 1 took Voyager 2. Yeah, okay.
How long ago was Pioneer?
How long ago was it? What year?
I don't know. Voyager 2 took 4 years.
See?
Okay, and how long ago was that?
I don't know.
In the past, spacecrafts have taken
a great amount of time to make it to Saturn. You know what's weird is Voyager 1 less time.
Voyager took 4 years, and Cassini's spacecraft took 6 years and 9 months to arrive. So, and Voyager 1 took 3 years. So, 3 years. So, hold on. When was Voyager 1? Let's see.
Why is the older one faster?
Maybe it was lighter, not as heavy. Who knows?
They didn't send that many instruments. You don't know what they sent with it.
Weight wouldn't really matter in space.
You might be right. And no, I don't know.
That's the question. You know, I should have my friend who works at NASA on here.
Voyager 1 was launched on September 5th, 1977. Mike, that was 40 years ago. I think we might have better technology now than we did then. So it might
be still going to take a long ass time.
So Voyager 1 has been out there for mission duration is 42 years. So I guess it's still out there. The Voyager 1 space probe.
Voyager 1 has left our solar system and is now just floating around the galaxy.
Yeah, but we're not going to get any communication back from that shit.
We are still?
Still?
I believe so.
How long does it take to send some shit back from outside of our solar system?
Months.
It's got to be longer than months.
Well, we went down a rabbit hole, and
we sure the fuck did.
Also,
here we go. Fly by Saturn, the gravitational asset trajectory of Jupiter was successfully carried up by both Voyager, and the two spacecrafts went on to visit Saturn and its system of moons and rings.
So Voyager's one extended mission is expected to continue until about 2025 when its radioscope thermoelectric generators will no longer supply enough electric power to operate its instruments.
Voyager 1 and I are the same age.
Wow, right. You are old, Sharmane.
Yeah.
It was released in September 1977. I was born in December of 1977.
Huh. Look at these pictures from Voyager 1. This is like 1980. This is incredible.
Technology is crazy because we're getting those images back and shit.
So I'm going to end this on, I need Sharmane and Mike and Devin to watch The Expanse.
I watched it, Brandon. I haven't watched season 4, though.
Season 4 is not out yet.
I didn't finish watching all of season 3.
So we can do a preview before the show comes out in December, season 4.
Okay.
Because The Expanse is exactly what Sharmane was talking about.
Okay, but are you going to make me watch this and then not invite me for the recap?
No.
Because you and I were supposed to do Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and look at how far we are, and we never once talked about it.
But we haven't talked about it on the show.
We didn't talk about it either, yeah.
Because I keep hearing
Mike and Devin not watching Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and I'm raising my hand like I fucking watch it.
Devin always watched Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
It was Mike.
Okay.
Mike is in and out with it, but I am dedicated because it's a great show. But I think we lost Brandon again. So
you didn't lose me.
No,
I'm here.
Okay. Mike,
what? So yeah, we have to watch. We gotta watch. I cannot wait for The Expanse. Oh, now when I'm so excited, like I get fucking giddy thinking about
you
Expanse.
Know
that shit is so good.
So I wanted to end this. I want to find the information before I say it, but I want to end this on a mysterious space fact.
Okay. What the fuck?
Mysterious space facts.
What do you have?
A mysterious space fact. Are there any non-mysterious space facts?
This is pretty wild.
I mean, we're like regular ass.
Oh, here we go, Mike. Let's do a couple more of these while you're looking this up. Boston Dynamics robot dog is now available for select customers.
Fuck out of here. I'm done. Because that shit was scary.
What did you say?
The Boston Dynamics robot dog is now available for some customers.
I'm going to buy it.
Some customers. That means rich white people.
Let me see what else. 15-ton fighting robot up for auction on eBay.
Can you climb in it?
No, it's just as big as a robot with guns. Biz on this huge battle bot started at $1, but sold over $50,000.
Scientists have discovered mysterious repeating radio signals from deep space. Earth is being bombarded with mysterious invisible light. Among the typical array of radio signals, microwaves cast out by distant stars, black holes, and other celestial bodies, there exists a brand of intergalactic light that constantly boggles scientists' minds and their instruments. Signals known as fast radio burst. Blah, blah, blah. Basically, I read a while ago that we picked up a weird, like, 70-second transmission from space, like, from not one of our stuff, and then it lasted for 70 seconds. It was all static, and then it disappeared. We've never heard it again.
Didn't I think I read somewhere that, like, something's happening to, like, our universe. Like, a lot of shit is just disappearing recently.
Cool. That's cool. Maybe there is a Thanos.
Okay. But yeah, that's the way to end it right there, Brandon. That shit was yeah.
What, that's good?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, so last thing we'll do is, Sharmane, tell everybody about your shows and what you got coming up.
Let's see, Militantly Mixed. Actually, next week I'm going to be chatting with the curly-haired Shinobi from the Black Ninja group family. I got to interview the Black Ninja for Blurred Comics a couple weeks ago and met the curly-haired Shinobi through there. She's a mixed girl. And then, let's see, we just reviewed Mixed-ish on Blurred Comics because, you know, we're both a couple of mixed black blurreds, so we had to talk about that. And the last installment of the Bisexual Visibility Celebration episode of Bi-Furious is coming out on Friday, the 27th. And I got a couple other irons in the fire of other things that I want to do, but I need money to do them. So as soon as I get the capital, more things.
Awesome. 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 Sharmane, we missed you on the show.
I miss you guys,
so too. I cannot wait.
I'm mad you're leaving California, but I also understand.
I'm moving California.
I just Dallas, wish Texas. I got you up here in Inglewood instead of fucking lost you to Dallas.
Listen,
that's,
if I would have, if we'd have moved to Inglewood, we probably wouldn't have been moving. But alas, things happen for a reason, and now we're going to the great state of Texas, where my wife was on here yesterday on the computer looking up the gun laws of Texas and couldn't believe what she was reading.
And she's getting one, so.
No, that's not happening. That's not happening.
She's going to get her license. She's going to get a concealed
carry
license.
You don't
need
a fucking license.
Oh, you don't need a license.
No.
Fuck.
Anyone
that's
can
even scary.
Carry again. Yeah. You don't need a background check either, so you can just roll up, buy a gun, and conceal carry it. Cash.
There's just certain buildings that you can't go into, and you can tell which buildings those are because they have a handgun with a circle, a Ghostbuster circle, and cross through it.
And now they're trying to remove those because of the mass shootings. So they're making it easier for you to take guns into schools and churches and places like that.
So silly.
So
more guns. That's what's going to solve this problem.
More guns. That's what we
more
need.
More guns.
So we will be back soon. Devin needs to go see Hustlers. If he doesn't see it, Rashani and I will be doing a review on Hustlers.
I saw it.
You saw it? Did you like it?
Yeah, I liked it.
Did you like
Boom,
Jennifer
there
Lopez's,
you go. Y'all got it.
Did you like Jennifer Lopez's twerking?
I would say that was a less than awesome routine.
Less than awesome routine. What about a 50-year-old?
I mean, she's dope anyway. Like, she's out there still making moves. So, but in comparison to what she does out on the stage versus what she did on the stage in the movie, it was less than awesome in the movie.
Devin, they had Jennifer Lopez for the first half of the movie in like a thong the entire time.
Yeah, she's basically in a thong most of the time.
I'm cool. I'm good, though. She's attractive, but I'm good. Hey, y'all do it. Charmaine, boom, I'm out. Get Sonny. Boom, you got it. Review Hustlers. I'm excited about it. Yes, I don't have to go see it.
Why are you trying to get out of your job?
I mean, because what I'm saying is you just pass it on. And it's sharing is caring, Brandon. That's what I'm here.
I mean,
here to share.
Are you going to pay my guest fee or something because you dipped out and I'm taking your job? Or, like, how's this working?
What I'm saying is get a credit, girl. You know what I mean? Plug your show some more. That's the gift right there.
Did I get my little souvenir from Japan?
See, nobody asked for nothing.
You better go back in the group chat.
Oh, hold on. You know, I didn't have internet service when I was over there. Said Wi-Fi. I just got on the Wi-Fi.
Oh, it's not even in the group chat. It's in your Facebook post about going to Japan.
Hold on, what?
Look at that.
Yeah. You see? Yep.
You owe me and Stephanie.
Yeah. I ain't get nobody any souvenirs except my godson, and I'm just giving him the stuff I bought myself. So
it's a shame. Mike, do you have anything else?
Nope. Not after my weird space news.
So next week I'll be on Jeff versus the World podcast reviewing the first week of the Wednesday Night Wars in pro wrestling, which starts next week. And next week's also the first episode of SmackDown Live on Fox. It's in L.A., and I really want to go.
Wow.
I really want to go because I think The Rock's going to be there. But I don't know if I'm going to go up there for it. But
pro wrestling. Because you got to come up for Comic-Con.
I am coming for Comic-Con later this month. Mike is going to New York Comic-Con. Next week, right, Mike?
Yeah, Wednesday. Next Wednesday. I probably won't talk to anybody until after we get back, I guess, unless we record on
TV. Are you cosplaying?
Yes.
Have you finished your Captain Marvel, boy Captain Marvel costume?
No, but I might buy some pieces for that at New York Comic Con. I've been so busy.
So Mike is going to go to Comic Con, and I'm still thinking I can get Mike to... I just ordered the... business cards, so I'm hoping I can get them to you before you go. So we'll see if I can overnight them and get them there to you. But Mike's going to go to Comic-Con and have fun up there. So until next week sometime, I'm not sure what day, but we'll be back next week. Thanks again, Sharmane, for coming on. You can follow,
thanks for having me.
Subscribe to all her shows on iTunes and anywhere else you get your podcasts up. The same with my show. Leave us a 5-star review. It helps us out both a lot. Sharmane has a Patreon, so if you love her shows, please donate to her Patreon and help her out. That's very, very good. Very much worth the money to do so. And Devin, Mike, and I will be back next week. So until then, talk to you later.